What's going on, YouTube fan? It's your boy Tony Two Times, and we back with another episode of the Baltimore Way, man. I appreciate the love and support like always. Y'all know what I need y'all to do. Be sure to like, comment, share the video if you're feeling the content. I'ma give y'all the video. I promise y'all the AB story. That's an abbreviation for his name. You feel me? He go by the name of Bird, and he was with the Stanfield Bates organization. The real Marlo story that I did. Let's get right into it. When we are young playing with friends, hooping or playing football, you can't imagine 15 years from now, one of your homeboys ending up being notorious or friends dropping like flies. Life has a funny way of humbling us. For one young man growing up in Baltimore, Maryland as a kid, the streets was the last thing on his mind. AB, AKA Bird, was growing up in the 70s in the inner city, back when neighbors still looked out for each other and before Section 8 forced fathers out the homes. Bird's step-pops had a good job at a steel company, earning enough to take care of his family and put food on the table every night. His mom was a housewife and stayed home raising the 7 kids. Bird's childhood was pretty good. Once saying in an interview, he never knew how it was to go hungry at night. He even played sports, peewee football and little league baseball. He loved football back when the Colts was still the Baltimore Colts. Bird was a huge fan, taking the money he got from doing his chores and going to games. So with this great upbringing like this, how can anything go wrong, right? Well, despite all the love around Bird and positive men to look up to, that wasn't his role models. It was the street hustlers who were on the corners by the Murphy Home Projects in which he grew up in. They had the cars, clothes, girls, and the money. The admiration would have Bird becoming a runner before he was even a teenager. He would grab or deliver duffel bags with smack in it. Even once running across a field of a little league game with a duffel bag to drop off, full of smack. The old heads took a liking to Bird because he was fast and always on point. By the age of 12, Bird was in the game. He started buying zips of grass and selling Knicks or volume, which went for $2 a pop. He eventually graduated to the big leagues, smacking coke, which Bird was getting off 500 bags of smack and 300 bags of coke a day. Coming from the projects, Bird was plugged into some very big players in the game and would eventually link up with the infamous Stanfield Bates organization. The Wire portrayed in the show that Stanfield was a ruthless organization in which they would hit your head about anything. But of course, we know that's just one side of the story. Once Bird turned 17, he was a major part of the team. Some would even call him the muscle, who enforced the reputation and respect of the squad. Things move fast in the street life, as Bird would learn. Some people he grew up with was dropping, and the Baltimore streets in the 80s was like a jungle. Money was plentiful, but so was the violence. One of Bird's friends got hit in the head right in front of him in his car, and at the time, all he could do was run. This affects you in some ways that some people could never imagine. Bird knew this wasn't a game, and it makes you become aggressive. The organization had the street fame, the money, women, cars. Same dudes Bird looked up to when he was younger, he was now one of them. Stanfield and Bates were under investigation, running territories in Murphy Homes and Westport. Bird knew the heat was on. Some alleged violence was said to have happened in which some of the organization big dudes had to put in work in order to keep their rep right. The streets were talking and Bird's name was in it. Once the feds swooped in, Bird, being young and cocky at the time, didn't think anything about it. Five members of the organization was tried together in 1987. They were charging the team with bodies and hitting witnesses. The verdict came back guilty. Bird couldn't believe it, but he knew he couldn't look soft. So all five members of the crew laughed at the judge as Bird was given a life sentence at just 20 years old. Years later, behind bars in the feds in Florida, Bird gives an interview in which he reflects on the younger version of himself, saying, I never whacked no one, honestly. The police was just mad because we wouldn't cooperate against Bates and Stanfield. But AB now says Bird is dead and gone. He admits he did not have to take this path. He didn't have a rough childhood. He reflects on the laughing at the life sentence, saying, "I was really sick. Stomach was tight," saying all he kept thinking about, if he passes out in court, he would be on the front page of the paper and it would read, "The tough bird faints." So he had to play cool and play tough. These days, after over 30 years in prison, Bird is a changed man, helping disabled inmates, making capes and designs, with the Colts still being his favorite football team, even though they left Baltimore. Bird has wrote many books. He walked into prison as an ignorant punk, he said, thinking his drug money would get him out of the jam. But now a man who feels like decades in prison actually saved his life, saying another year or two on the streets, he probably would have been gone and not here today to tell the story. Free Bird, man. In life, we are faced with choices. Who would have known as a kid just running smack would end up to him being a part of a notorious organization? The game doesn't wait for you to figure it out. It figures you out or gets you out. Man, salute the Bird, man. Well, I mean, he say Bird is gone, so I'ma call him AB, you know what I mean? And like I said, this extended episode of the Real Marlo Stanfield story. You know, this is one of his peoples, you feel me? They had a team. They wasn't too deep. Five of them was tried and convicted. He went down in this group. And this man been down for over 30-something years, you know? And I feel like, you know, seeing his interview and reading some things about him, he grew a lot as a man. And sometimes it be messed up that people got to leave the streets to really get that clear mindset to understand who they really are. You feel me? Now, he says, and I believe him, that he ain't really never hit nobody. You know what I mean? He said they had enough respect. They ain't really had to do all that. He said things went on, but he didn't do it. But he didn't cooperate, in which I don't think none of them cooperated. So it ain't too many groups out here like that. So they had to pretty much pin things on them to make it stick. But man, you know, that's a long time for anybody, you know what I mean? I feel like he served his debt to society. You know, he was 20 years old. This 87. I was born in 87. I'm 34 years old. So that's how long this man been incarcerated. You know, and of course, I feel like they had a strong team and they was militant. And like I always tell y'all, when they see us moving like that, it put fear in their heart and they gotta get you out of here, man. But Free Bird, man, you know, this was a dope story. I felt like this was an interesting story. I got two more videos about this crew, man. Then we're going to move on to some different things. And I'm going to start a new segment. I appreciate the love and support. Be sure to like, comment, share the video. Love, fam. I'm out.